MPD, according to MPD, millennials, which are 18 to 34-year-olds, are the single largest source of traffic at QSR since 2007. It's an important group. They obviously eat out a lot. They spend more than any other generation, although it's probably their parents' money that they're spending, I kind of figure. How is Tim Hortons going to capitalize on the power of this important consumer group moving forward?
We very much match the population of Canada. So we're getting people coming into our stores right across the spectrum. Right from the 18 to the 34s, right through the
right.
So we match up very, very nicely. No surprise, because we are Canada's brand, right? But again, it talks to our ability to evolve, our ability to engage. We've always done, I think, a good job of catering to these younger consumers, right? I think we need to do a better job of engaging with them. And there's a big difference between catering and engagement. We want to talk to them. We want to hear from them. And when you look at some of the changes that we're making in our restaurants, to make it more comfortable for them to come in a restaurant, they're not going to sit on these hard, chairs. So we put lounges in there. We put the fireplace in there. We put the TV in there to make it more comfortable for them. They're totally hooked to technology, right? So they can bring their computers in. There's Wi-Fi in there. They can pay with their smartphone. So we're really looking at those things that are important to this particular age group, and we're trying to cater to them. In QSR, there's what we call demand spaces or occasions. There's 11 of them, and if you add them all up, the 11 demand spaces equals to 22 billion, which is the industry. Mm-hmm. And Tim Hortons participates very, very well in four of them. In fact, we control four demand spaces: caffeine fix, mm-hmm. morning day part. But there are seven of them, right?
That you don't.
That we don't. And it's not to say that we want to do business with all seven, because then you're going to be.
What are some of those seven?
Well, again, I was on the road trips. I was able to take some of this with me. I'll give you the there's actually nine demand spaces. See, Cynthia was looking at me. She says, he screwed up again. I knew that. There's nine. There's the coffee fix,
right,
which we do very, very well. There's breakfast on the run, which we do very, very well. There's a treat break. We dominate treats.
Snack day,
yes,
part.
Mm-hmm. In the morning. Morning leisure is another one, which we do very, very well. But then there's healthcare, health consciousness. We don't, we could do better there. We have this halo effect, but we don't do a very good job of communicating nutrition, health, and wellness.
And that's a huge trend these days.
And that's a huge trend. So that's an opportunity. Modest comfort is another one. I'm not quite sure what that means, but that's for the marketing guys to decide. Family time. We don't get a lot of families into our restaurants.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So that's an opportunity. The eighth one is something called Just Feed Me, right? And I think that we attracted some of those with their crispy chicken sandwich, Just Feed Me. Something here called Satisfy a Craving. So again, I'm a simple sales guy, so I have no idea what these things mean here, but our marketing people understand what these mean. So, we're gonna look at these things, and we're gonna decide, where we do really, really, really well today. We're gonna continue to drive that. But of these remaining, five, what
sure.
are we going to go after? So it's not just about the millennials or the seniors. It's about, even being more specific, more focused. And what is this new era? This new era is low growth. Get used to it. You're not going to have the growth that you had before, not just in Canada, but all over the world. Low growth. What happens with low growth? You get competitive intensity. Why do you get competitive intensity? Because everybody needs to grow. If there's no growth, how are you going to grow? You're going to steal it
from others.
Right. And who are you going to steal it from? The biggest, us, right? So, and then you have a consumer in this new era that's very, a little bit anxious, a little bit of anxiety, uncertain, very value conscious, but very well connected, mm-hmm. Through technology, completely in charge, right? So this is this new era that we're gonna have to learn to compete in. And the point that I'm trying to make here, You can't just compete in this new era with a machine gun. You got to be very, very focused. And then this, again, I go back to, you know, I'm very happy with the new marketing person that we have coming in, because he's going to do exactly this for us. You got to really be focused on those areas that you want to go after. So it becomes really a marketing challenge and really understanding the consumer.
You have 3,588 units in Canada. And you're saying that in terms of your new strategic plan that you're looking to add between 140 to 160 new locations in Canada this year for a total of 500 over the next 5 years. We mentioned, or we alluded earlier, that, you know, perhaps the market in Canada is almost there. Is it saturated for Tim Hortons? Where is this expansion going to take place in Canada? Because you are pretty much everywhere.
Yeah.
And what kind of new units are you looking to build as part of that strategy?
One of my mentors that I mentioned earlier was Peter Brabeck, the chairman of Nestle. And one of the things that he taught me was that there's no such thing as a mature market. There's only mature managers. and that's true. There is always ways to find growth. Once you stop growing, that is when you start to die. so you better be able to find growth. And for us, there's lots of ways that we're going to grow. Mark is going to build 500 restaurants for us between now and 2018. But that's just the beginning. If you walk around downtown Toronto, we're not happy with the number of restaurants we have in downtown Toronto. We need to, and it's not just Toronto, it's urban centers. Because this brand started in the small communities and worked their way in, mm-hmm. and we really haven't penetrated places like Toronto and Vancouver and some of these. So a lot more focus in urban centers. But you're also not going to see the same type of stores that you see in Aurora. Mm-hmm. So you're going to see smaller formats, smaller footprints, smaller boxes, kiosks. And in downtown Toronto alone, between Jarvis, University, Bloor, and Lakeshore, he's nodding, so he agrees, we're going to have 50 new restaurants over the next couple of years. And our business will always be restaurants. Our business will always be restaurants. That's who we are. But there's also opportunities, I think, to take our business beyond restaurants. Mm-hmm. This is one of the most trusted brands. It is the most trusted brand that we have in Canada, right? So there's opportunities for us to take this brand outside of our restaurants. Now, we're going to be responsible about it. We're going to be very pragmatic, but we're going to do it.
What do you mean when you say that?
Well, let me give you an example. We talked about coffee. One of the things that's impacting coffee today is single serve.
Right.
Right, which is, if you're not, if you guys are surprised in Canada over this single serve, you shouldn't be, because it's been, you know, a phenomenal success in Europe for you know, 30 years. But single serve is one of those areas that's mm-hmm. impacting out-of-home coffee.
Right.
So we're going to take single serve from not only being available in our restaurants, but we're also going to make it available in other channels.
I see. Okay.
So in June of this year, you're going to see Tim Hortons single serve coffee being available in supermarkets, right? And there'll be other products to follow, other products. Ready to drink is another area. Ready to drink beverages is one of the fastest growing areas that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Why? And our focus is coffee. Our focus, our heritage is coffee. Why should we not have ready-to-drink coffee beverages, Tim Hortons, and beverage stores, in convenience stores?
Interesting.
Right? So again, we're going to be pragmatic, we're going to be responsible, we're going to do it. And when we do that, it's not at the expense of our franchisees, because again, I go back to our business first and foremost is franchises. So we will also offer those products in the franchise, but we will also share with our franchisees any success that we enjoy outside of the restaurants.
You currently have 859 units in the States, but there seems to be some challenges around that U.S. expansion. What do you see as the challenges, and what do your expansion plans in the U.S. look like today?
You know, you look at this market. You know, it's the world's largest food service market. It continues to grow. The population will continue to grow. Politically, you know, you may not agree, but it's pretty stable politically. Environmentally, it's not bad. We speak the same language.
Right.
So why would we not want to be in this market? Well, because it's competitive. Well, yeah, but show me any market in the world that's not competitive. You know, every single market today is competitive. And we're there now. Mm-hmm. We're there with, as you said, Rosanna, with, you know, 850 plus stores. Some of those stores are doing, you know, really, really well. Others we need to do better. At the end of the day, we acknowledge that we weren't happy with our performance in the U.S. So, you know, the truth is important. Mm-hmm. But we also learned some things about the U.S. business. First and foremost, it's not the same as Canada, mm-hmm. right? No, and that's one of the mistakes. You know, if you think that you're going to go down there and act like you do up here, you're wrong. You know, there's different needs. So you have to respect, and I also learned this very early, there's no such thing as a global consumer. You know, consumers are local, local mm-hmm. taste, local. So we put a team in place that does nothing but focus on the U.S. And the head of that is our president for the U.S., Mike Mayer, who's not here. The other thing that we learned is, and we did extensive research in those markets that we're in. The good news is that we have two things. We have awareness and we have convenience. So people know who we are. People know what we stand for. Cafe and bake shop.
You have right? a different name in the States.
Yeah, because we had to stand for something. In Canada, everybody knows who's... So we don't have to describe ourselves. In the U.S., nobody, you know, very few people know who we are. So we had to establish an identity, which was cafe and bake shop. But again, I go back to the two good things. We have awareness and we have convenience. So our business in the U.S. is really a morning business. It's a breakfast business. It's a coffee business. The fact that we have awareness and convenience tells us that the challenge that we have is to build loyalty beyond the morning day part.
Right.
So again, it becomes a marketing challenge. In the past, we've always used our own money. Mm-hmm. You know? Well, we're not going to use our money anymore. We're going to align ourselves with the right types of partners. The right type of partners are people not only have the capital, because today there's a lot of people with money today. That's not the issue. Huh? But we're going to align ourselves with people that really understand the market, people that have access to things like real estate, people that have access to things like media, supply chain, and we'll partner with them. Right? We'll partner with them. So it's a slightly different model mm-hmm. than what we're accustomed to. But I think it's a model that will allow us to go faster than we have in the past.
You also have units in the Middle East,
yes.
which was a little surprising to me in terms of why there. You have, I believe, 38 units there currently, and you're planning to add a total of 220. That's a fairly huge investment. Why there?
The Middle East is an interesting part of the world. It continues to grow. It's also the gateway for you know, a lot of people go through the Middle East to get to other parts of the world. And it's not really the Middle East, it's really the Gulf Council. You know, it's Dubai, it's Abu Dhabi, and that part of the world. But more importantly, we really came across the right partner. And that for me was key. And the partner here is somebody called the Apparel Group. And these people know the market intimately. They have access to real estate. They control a lot of the malls. They have access to media. They have a lot of money. They really believed in the brand. So it was an opportunity for us to align ourselves with the right partners in a very important part of the world because it's a gateway, so we're going to get a lot of exposure. And it's really worked. You mm-hmm. know, it's one of these models that I tried to explain earlier. We didn't put any capital in. The capital is put in by our partner. We take a royalty, so every month we get a check, which is fantastic, right? Every month you get a check, it's good. We don't have to do anything else. And it's a model that we're looking to expand in other parts of the world with the right type of partner. So that's something to look forward to over the coming months.
A couple of weeks ago, CBC aired an edition of Marketplace that focused on food safety transgressions in the industry, and they cited several large chains that were found to have some food safety violations. The report called for the food service industry to post restaurant inspections, similar to what Toronto has currently, that was mandated several years ago in Toronto. What's Tim's position on national restaurant inspections?
Look, I've had the privilege of traveling the world in the 8 years that I was at Nestle's. And I can tell you, you know, and I've eaten in the best restaurants in the world. I've also eaten in restaurants that would not be considered to be, very good. I've eaten in local wet markets. So I've seen it all. I've seen it all. When you talk about food safety in Canada, in my view, you're talking about one of the best in the world in terms of how that's managed. To me, it's not a concern. Mm-hmm. It's not a concern. We have a very rigorous program at Tim Hortons. We take it very seriously. We have our own special teams that audit these things. So we have the tools in place. I think the responsibility that we all have is to ensure that our food continues to be as safe and as delicious as it is.
What do you do specifically at Tim Hortons to promote food safety? Do you do extensive training?
Well, we have
your
training.
Staff?
I mean, you guys are involved in that.
Train camp?
You've been part of that for a number of years through your company, and that's worked really, really well. We have our own inspection team. We do, I think, what is it, two audits per year? Every single restaurant gets two audits per year. So, the rigor is there. And the accountability is there, I'm one of these people. I don't like rules and regulations. I don't like to be told what to do by people. But, if you're principle-driven and value-driven, you'll always do the right thing.